I appreciate this morning. I appreciate the Lord's heart to share his heart with us, because we need it. We need his wisdom, and he knows that, and I'm thankful for it. And I was just thinking, you know, some of what Phil was saying there, I've been thinking as we were praying about this service, and you know, there's a picture given in Revelation there after the picture that's depicted the battle there at the cross and how Satan couldn't win and he was cast out of heaven and he went. You know, the thing is, after his war against God failed, he redirected his focus to make war against the woman and her seed. That became his focus. And part of his doing that, the way it's depicted there in that passage, is that he sent a flood out of his mouth to sweep her away. Well, the earth opened up its mouth and drank up that flood, but God provided a place of safety for her. As a picture there of God bringing forth the church in the earth and what happened there, but that idea of Satan sending out a flood, that's not a physical water flood. That's ideas. It's philosophies. It's thoughts. And it's things that are against the Word of God. And we see it. I mean, our culture is busting at the seams with perversions of what God created and twisting of what God's word plainly says in all kinds of areas. That's the result of that flood. But his intent, you know, it deceived the world. It opened up its mouth and drank it up. But his intent in sending it out was not to deceive the world. It was to carry the woman away with that. It was the church, God's people. And thankfully, God, when the enemy does come in like that, he will raise up the standard of his word to give us a standard. It's not that it becomes about the standard, because if we ever divorce the word from the author of the word, then we end up being standard bearers. We end up with just a bunch of rules and creeds to offer and not a living Savior. And then when the two don't work together, you've got a problem. But he has given us truth. And, you know, I was thinking about, well, just right there in Proverbs. We all know this scripture anyway. It's in Proverbs 1:7. But it says here, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. You know, in Corinthians, he talks about how God has hidden things from the wise and prudent. He's revealed them to babes. He didn't call many wise and many mighty and many powerful, you know, people. There are a lot of people in this world who are very learned, but the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. I don't care what degrees they have behind their name. And I think sometimes that's intimidating to people. And you know, I know the tendency when you're looking for information or looking for wisdom, you know, we live in a culture now where information is very accessible, much more so than it was even 20 or 30 years ago. You can go online and find anything that anybody's ever written about anything. But, you know, you have to be careful doing that. I would say be careful doing that. I'd say be careful if you have a question about things in the Word of God. Be careful about just Googling stuff, because you will find yourself in a mess of confusion in a hurry if you go looking at some of that stuff. There is so much out there that's not from the Word of God. You can get your head in a spin, in a fog, trying to just take in all these different opinions. What we want to do, and that's not that we can't learn anything from that. There are things that we can be gained, even from secular sources that can have wisdom. But the Scripture talks about bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ that comes in. It can't just be drunk in, well, here's an expert, and we drink that in. We need to weigh that against the Word of God and have balance in that, because there are things that we can learn, you know, from these people who studied things. There may be some things that could be useful there, but we can't uncritically drink that in. Just like there are people who have some very impressive credentials that would tell you with very much confidence that you evolved from apes and that this world came into being with no creator. And these people would be very confident about that. And I'm sorry, despite all their knowledge, people way smarter than me, despite all their knowledge, I can't drink that in, because that's contrary to the Word of God. There's a difference there. There's a standard here that we can't depart from, because this is the Word of a God who cannot lie. He's the one who made the universe. He knows how it's supposed to work because he created it. And so that's what I want. And I want us to, you know, God help us to find that balance, because a lot of the wisdom that you get out there, and as Phil mentioned, it revolves around the fact that kids are too young to understand whatever, or they can't understand. That is not so. That is not so. Because for one thing, kids, no matter, even very little kids can respond to love. And that's what we're talking about here this morning. This is about love. And even very little kids can understand and respond to love. But I remember when you know, Philip was first born, we had read some things about teaching sign language, you know, to kids, little signs, because there's a point where they can't talk. They can't communicate, but they can understand what you're saying. And they just can't say it back to you yet. And before he was even a year old, there were probably 15 or 20 different things he could tell us very clearly when he wanted. I can remember doing little signs when he wanted more. He was tired, when something hurt, or he was time to get a bath. I mean, he had all these little signs he could do. We would teach him. We would say it and show it and do it. And in no time, you know, kids do not get given enough credit for what they understand. I think at all ages, there is a tendency to belittle what they can understand at the age they're at. And God help us to not do that, because These things are critical. They are important. And God wants us to just be teaching them according to his word. And the key point, I think, that Phil brought out, I actually thought about a scripture that Paul, or something Paul said when he was talking about it being in love. You remember in 1 Corinthians 13, where he's talking about love being patient and kind and all those things. But he talks about, you know, I could do all these great things. I could have all kind of wisdom. I could speak in great prophecies. I could speak in the tongues of angels. He went through this long list of great spiritual stuff he could do. But he said, but if I don't have love, it's just noise. You know what I mean? It's useless. So what good would it be if I could preach a great sermon if there's not love behind it? What good is it going to do? What good would it be for me to, you know, give everything I have to charity, or give my body to be burned in the name of Christ? But if it's not love motivating it, then what is it? You know, that's the key point. Yes. The key point here is not to get our kids to obey or not to get our kids to be quiet. That's not really the goal. That's more like a byproduct of the goal. What the real goal is to transmit the nature of Christ, the fruit of the Spirit to them, to form the fruit of the Spirit in them. And then there will be obedience to authority and there will be self-control and all that. But we're not going for that as the end goal. It's the love of God that wants us to give them the fruit of the Spirit so that they can experience that. Because it's too easy for it to become about these other goals. And, you know, like Phil said, a lot of times there gets to be self in it. I want my kid to behave so I don't look bad. That's human pride, folks, and we all got it, and we've all experienced it, and that's not the time to discipline, because kids are not stupid. Again, they understand things, and when they see that, oh, they're mad because I embarrassed them, then that tells them, oh, this discipline's not really for my good. It's for their benefit. It's about them, not about me. God help us, and we are all imperfect. We need his grace, but God help us that this is the underlying thing, the love of God. And, you know, when you have to discipline, it needs to be communicated that we do love you, that this is not because we don't love you. And, you know, the kids might not understand it. At different ages, they understand different things. And I remember having to tell my kids, that doesn't make sense. Why are you disciplining me if you love me? Well, I just had to tell them, if I didn't love you, I wouldn't care what you did. I wouldn't care. The reason we care is because we love you. And that's got to be the message, because just like when we look at God, the way God works with people to bring them to himself, he does not come with a message of condemnation. He does not come with clenched fists. He doesn't come telling them how bad they are. He came with love. That's why people responded to him. People from all walks of life in all kinds of situations responded to the love they saw in him, and that's what drew them. And that's really what's going to speak to our kids. Yes. Not just the fact that not anything else other than that. It needs to be the love of God. They will respond to that. They can understand that and respond to that. And God has to help us. He has to give us wisdom. That's why he did not simply give us a rule book and say, here's the rule book. Because if we think we have a rule book, what happens is it cuts us off from communicating with him because we don't think we need to. We think, well, here's the rule book. What do I need from God? It's right here. And you just do it. We don't have that. Kids are different, situations are different, but there are some principles that are universally true. And I believe the Lord is sharing some of those with us this morning. But within that, there will be times and situations that are different. Not every situation is the same. I tell you what Phil mentioned, there are times, and God has to give us wisdom as parents to understand this. But when spirits get involved, spanking's not going to affect that spirit. You can spank that child and it's not going to hurt that spirit. There are times when the answer is not that, it's to come against the enemy. There's a spiritual battle that has to be fought as well. And God has to give us wisdom for that. I mean, we don't have the understanding we need without him helping us to understand. But you know what we have found, me and my wife have remarked on it many times over the years, that God gives wisdom when it's needed. We've talked about learning to trust those leadings that he gives, you know, because so many times he's proven himself faithful, where you just feel like we need to do this, or this is going on, or this is what needs to happen. And then God would prove out that, yes, that was correct, because it came from him. It was peaceable. And that's just part of us asking him, God, you lead us. We want to be led by you, because he can do those things. He can lead us to know in different situations what's exactly the right thing to do. But the other thing I wanted to say is that is critical in this is that there be unity in the home. Unity between the mother and the father when it comes to this, because you know, the enemy, he takes advantage of anything he can. And well, Jesus even talked about the time they accused him of, you know, casting out spirits by Beelzebub. He said, well, if any kingdom or any house that's divided against itself, it's not going to be able to stand. You know, that was the example he used. And there's a truth in that. If we are not together, because, you know, the scripture, I thought about the scripture that said, Talks about fathers not frustrating your children, you know, in your discipline. Don't frustrate them. Well, one of the most frustrating things to a kid, and I've seen this from, you know, our own things we haven't done right before, is inconsistency. You know, one day it's like this and another day it's like that. It's very frustrating for a child because they are trying to find those boundaries. And if, you know, if they go here and they don't find a boundary, well, I guess I got to keep going. Is it here? No. Well, is it here? You know, but then if those boundaries are changing, that's frustrating to a child. And when the mother and father are not on the same page, constantly shifting boundaries makes it impossible for them to find where is that line, where's that place that I need to stop. And so, you know, God help us to communicate and to be on the same page and ask him for the wisdom, because again, he gave your child to you. They're unique from everybody else. Their path is, like you said, unique, not separate, but they are unique. And he's given you and your the mother and the father special wisdom for what that child's going to need, because he purposed that child for you. That race that's marked out for us, that included having our children before they ever came on the scene, he knew about that. And he's prepared us and given us what we need for our children to be what they need us to be. But there needs to be a unity in that. So let's make sure to communicate in this and ask the Lord to give us that unity so that we can be on the same page for them. Because where there is unity, there God has commanded the blessing. And there's a barrier against the enemy. I remember in the past any number of times having to tell my kids, don't come and ask me a question you've already asked your mother, hoping you're going to get a different answer from me and start, you know, trying to put us against each other. Don't do that. We're together in this, you know. And God can help us with that. But I just wanted to say that's a critical point, that they know it's love, because all the other things you achieve, getting your kids to behave and act good and be polite and all that, if it wasn't love behind it, there's something missing. That's what we want it to be motivated by. And then for there to be unity, and God would help us do it together. He's so faithful. And I'll just say this too. I know some others may have something they want to share, but you know, as we've been talking about this and praying about this, it's good to have a service like this, an occasion to share. But, you know, there are some limitations here. You've only got so much time, and I know a lot of people wouldn't necessarily feel free to get up here and say things. You know, my wife wouldn't, and I'm sure many others wouldn't that would have good perspectives on some of this. But, you know, we've prayed about whether there would be appropriate to have a time to get together, you know, maybe with just a few of us and some of our, you know, anybody, parents with children that want to talk and just have a time to get together and share, you know, in a less formal environment than this, where people might just be free to share what they're thinking or what they're struggling with, and other parents can share it so that you know you're not alone, because you're not alone, by the way. Don't let the enemy tell you that these struggles are because something's wrong with you. All these things are common, you know, that your same afflictions are accomplished in your other brothers and sisters in the world. But, you know, we've been praying about whether that would be the case. So I don't know if there's anybody who feels like that would be a blessing to you to get together with some other parents at some point, maybe just in a home. I don't know how many it would be. But if you've got a burden for that or feel like that would be a blessing, just communicate that to some of us and let us pray about having a time just to get together with maybe some parents and a few others that we could just share and encourage and build each other up, because that's what we're here for, is the body of Christ. That's part of our calling, is to build one another up in the things that we go through. So if that's something you feel like might be a blessing, to have a time just to fellowship and share those things with others who are where you're at and can understand and encourage each other, then just let us know and be praying with us about that, because I believe the Lord, just he has wisdom for everything we need, every situation, and he wants to guide us. So I just thank him for this today, and just trust us will be a blessing. Praise God.